This video was made possible by Brilliant. Learn complex topics simply for 20% off by being one of the first 200 to sign up at brilliant.org/Wendover. The airline business model is broken. Back in late 2019, COVID-19 came along. Borders worldwide closed down. Businesses halted work travel. All but a select few individuals canceled their trips. In the time when all but the most critical contact was to be avoided to hold the virus at bay, travel was just not a risk worth taking for most. One of the most major issues for the airline industry, though, is not that demand is lower. Lower demand is bad, it's wreaking havoc on the industry, but it is a potentially surmountable problem. If an airline knew that 2020 would be 75% down, 2021 55% down, and 2022 30% down, the solution would be simple. They'd downsize their schedule, cut back on routes, unload assets, furlough employees, and just become a smaller airline for the next few years. These are, in fact, the tactics airlines are using regardless, but they don't fully solve the overall problem. That's because, even after airlines solve the problem of being too big for what the travel market has become, the true issue, the one that will plague the industry for the entirety of its period of recovery, is that even after they downsize, they just don't know how many people want to fly. Now, think back to travel in the time before coronavirus. How full were the planes you were on? How often was that seat next to you free? The answer is almost certainly sometimes, but not that often. On average, 85% of airplane seats in the US were filled in 2019, slightly higher than the world average of 83%. Some airlines achieved even better than this. Ryanair, for example, filled 96% of its seats in 2019. Now, simultaneously, when was the last time that you've gone to buy a ticket for a flight, but there were none available? This too certainly happens, but it's quite rare. It might cost quite a lot, but if you want to buy a ticket to a flight, it'll almost always be available, no matter how close to departure it is. This is very, very intentional. Now, normally, the day-to-day job of adjusting the price of flights to extract every potential dollar out of them is handled by computers, specifically the complex revenue management software on them. Around early March 2020, though, the computers started to go haywire. People weren't booking like they were supposed to, so the computers lowered the price. That should lead to bookings picking up, but they didn't, which confused the computers even more, which lowered the price further. This went on and on and on until the point where you could book flights from New York to London, for example, for just $1 or $200 round trip hours before departure. It'd be easy to say prices were low because demand was, but that's not exactly the truth. It's just a byproduct of the truth. The computers and their revenue management software were tasked to extract the most revenue possible regardless of demand. But in this case, they failed. Now, normally, businesses focus more on matching supply to demand, not demand to supply, because regulating demand is very, very difficult. Airlines, however, do both simultaneously. This is because they just can't regulate supply to match demand that well. Demand for travel fluctuates depending on which hour of which day of which year it is. Airlines just can't fluctuate their schedule to match that entirely. For example, airlines in the US making their 2020 schedules knew that last year, 2,487,398 people traveled in the US on the second Thursday in April, while 2,616,158 people did on the third Thursday. For the most part, though, airlines will operate the same schedules on both of those Thursdays. That's because the complexity of adjusting the schedule to such small changes just isn't worth the money it would save by operating slightly fuller flights. Therefore, rather than rapidly adjusting supply to match demand, they rapidly adjust demand to fit supply. You can see this in action by looking at travel trends. In the US, the least busy quarter in 2019 for air travel was the first, January, February, and March, with 210 million passengers. The most busy quarter, meanwhile, was the third, July, August, and September, with 243 million passengers. Now, that's not that much of a difference. The third quarter, including the height of the summer travel season, was only 16% busier than the first quarter, encompassing the depths of winter. But is it truly that demand is only 16% higher in the summer than winter, or is it that airlines are regulating demand to increase it in the winter and suppress it in the summer? All evidence points to the latter. So, airlines have this balancing act to perform. They want to be sure that they can capture as much of the high demand in the summer as possible, but they also don't want to have a bunch of planes and staff sitting around in the lower demand winter, as that costs quite a lot. Rather than flying a stable number of flights year-round or regulating demand to keep it stable year-round, they do a little of both and meet in the middle. The supply side is the easy bit. There is a certain predictable ebb and flow to the yearly cycle of travel for a given market for a given type of traveler. For example, take the American business traveler. Airlines know that the week with the lowest demand for travel from this demographic is the last of the year, after Christmas, followed by the first of the year, the second to last of the year, the week of the 4th of July, then the week of Thanksgiving. With this info, airlines can craft a schedule that, over those weeks, emphasizes leisure-focused destinations over business ones. They might decide that, in the last week of the year, they'll fly more flights to Florida and fewer to Chicago. Simultaneously, though, airlines know that September, October, and the week before Thanksgiving are the strongest period of the year for business travel, so they might increase the number of flights on common business routes over that time. So, airlines tweak their schedule mostly on a month-to-month or week-to-week basis, but for those day-to-day or hour-to-hour shifts in demand, they rely on regulating demand. The number one tool used to do this is pricing, and we can see this in action. Currently, if you want to book a ticket to fly United Airlines from Newark to Eagle County Airport in Colorado on January 1st, 2021, it would cost you $353. If you were to book United Airlines from Newark Airport to Denver International Airport on January 1st, though, it would cost you $134. So, flying to Eagle County is 2.5 times more expensive than flying to Denver, even though it is only 120 miles further from New York. To United, the cost of operating these two flights are nearly identical. It's the same aircraft type and roughly the same flight length. There might be slight economies of scale by flying to Denver as it's a bigger airport, and there's a greater potential of a flight diversion at Eagle County Airport since it's in the mountains, but overall, the costs are very similar. What accounts for the difference in price is demand, not cost. United Airlines thinks it knows that 4 months prior to the flight, it can charge $353 for the flight to Eagle County and still end up with a full plane. Meanwhile, to end up with a full plane to Denver, it has to price it at $134. These prices will increase as it gets closer to departure, but just because of the way people book their travel to Eagle County Airport, $353 is the right price right now. So, how does United know this? Well, because it's what it did last year, and it worked. Airlines' greatest asset truly is their data. United Airlines knows exactly how much they need to price their flights at a certain level of fullness and a certain number of days before departure, and that means they can eke out every single bit of potential revenue from a given flight. If United priced the Eagle County flight too high, they might end up with empty seats, which is terrible for an airline. Every time a plane takes off with an empty seat, the airline is losing out on potential revenue. Aside from taxes, airport fees, and catering costs, there's essentially no extra cost to carrying an additional passenger, so selling a cheap ticket over no ticket is always worth it. Simultaneously though, if an airline prices a flight too low, they might sell out of seats too early, losing out on the potential to sell high-priced tickets to last-minute travelers, who generally are those traveling for work who aren't paying for themselves. So, airlines rely on these price fluctuations to end up with a plane exactly full, exactly at departure, therefore, in theory, extracting the exact highest potential level of revenue from the flight. This makes the problem rather obvious. Airlines simply don't know what the recovery will look like. Specifically, the computers don't know how people will respond to changes in pricing, so they don't know how to extract the most possible revenue from a flight by ending up with an exactly full flight exactly at departure. The airline industry has had sharp drop-offs in demand before, but typically only in response to financial crises or terrorist attacks. In this case, in a pandemic, The closest equivalent happened 100 years ago, in 1918, when the commercial aviation industry was only in its infancy. Therefore, the aviation industry as a whole, and especially individual airlines, have no data and no idea what the demand patterns during and after a pandemic will be like. After the initial drop-off in travel and the plummet in pricing in response, airlines essentially turned off the computers, shut down the revenue management algorithms. They've gone back to relying on the humans, who traditionally are only there to tweak what the computer thinks. That's because the humans were able to realize something that the computers could not. Traditionally, airline demand is quite elastic. People will often decide whether or not to book based on the price. It is exactly this, in fact, that makes it possible for the airlines to regulate demand by changing prices. In the midst of the initial stay-at-home orders, though, the only type of person who would fly was someone who needed to fly, someone who would pay whatever it cost to get that ticket. Therefore, there was no sense in lowering prices because that wouldn't stimulate demand. It would only reduce revenue. They also didn't jack them up tremendously, cautious not to get into the public relations nightmare of price gouging, but they more or less just kept them stable to what a normal April would look like. As May came about, and there was a small initial restart to discretionary travel, most every American airline lowered prices by about 10 to 20% to stimulate demand slightly. The problem, though, is that there are still way too many variables impacting travel to accurately predict and stimulate demand. American Airlines, for example, took a big gamble in May when they were crafting their revised summer schedule. They accurately surmised that people who were vacationing in summer 2020 would be particularly interested in destinations where the focus was the outdoors, such as at the beach. They also knew that many of the traditional beach destinations that Americans travel to in the Caribbean would be shut behind closed borders, so demand for this type of vacation would naturally shift domestically to Florida. This hypothesis was further supported by the fact that, in May, when they were working on this schedule, Florida had one of the lowest rates of infection in the US. Therefore, the airline decided to add loads of capacity into Florida to account for the relatively high demand it expected. Of course, starting in early June, there began a steep spike in the state's COVID cases, leading to increased wariness among consumers to travel to the state. Also, on a more general level, much of the summer travel season in the US did not live up to airlines' expectations due to a second spike in nationwide case numbers and increasing domestic travel restrictions. Passenger demand trends returned slightly closer to the April 2020 scenario, where it was less and less the cost of travel that stimulated demand, and rather external conditions. COVID has turned the job of those in revenue management at airlines closer to an art than a science. With decades upon decades of data, airlines got good at modeling the predictable patterns of travelers, but failed to consider the possibility for the unimaginable. Now, not only is overall demand lower, but airlines can't even extract the same level of revenue from the same number of travelers on a given flight. This unpredictability has a quite literal monetary cost for airlines, so that means that, even when the travelers come back, even when the airports are full again, true recovery will not happen until passengers are predictable again. Uncertainty is not just a word. It's a force of nature that we can never get rid of, which is why mathematics has set up a system of tools to address it. The mathematics of uncertainty is fascinating and an incredibly powerful analytical tool, but it's an area of math that most people don't know a lot about. I certainly didn't until the new Brilliant course on knowledge and uncertainty came around. This and all of Brilliant's courses are designed so they take these big, complex subjects and teach them in an intuitive way. With visuals, interactive elements, and clear explanations, all you need to do to learn about uncertainty or computer science or math or science is commit to working through the course regularly. After watching this video, taking the course on uncertainty will be even more interesting for you, as you'll be learning the exact sort of math that those working in revenue management at airlines are using to try to work their way through their massive uncertainty problem. So, commit to learning today and be one of the first 200 to sign up at brilliant.org/wendover so you get a 20% discount.